Thank you. So thank you for coming. So I will just give a little presentation regarding continuous deployment pipeline on Nimbus. So Nimbus is a Cisco cloud services on a microservice application, and it will be also based on Docker. So I'm working within Cisco since the acquisition. I'm used to work with new technologies, and also I'm making innovation projects in 7 years. And also I'm working on improving the DevOps adoption. So if you have any question after, we'll get time to work on any subject. So I'm working on the CTO office led by David Ward, and I'm located in Paris, in France. So we'll go first through some context and objective, and then I will talk about microservice architecture, and later we'll go through all the deployment pipeline, and then we'll show you a quick demo. So just to give you some context, so we've built a framework to really ease the multi-screen experience in order to ease the deployment of multi-screen application. So basically, nowadays, we are using several devices, but it's really hard to provide an enhanced user experience on all this kind of device. That's why we decided to design a cloud project based and without any constraint on the application side. So we are language agnostic. We're just providing API, and then developer can easily build multi-screen application without taking care of managing all the device, the screens, and so on. And we definitely apply a DevOps approach in order to be really flexible and really be faster in terms of development. And we use Docker not because it's a trend. It's really solved a lot of issues regarding packaging the system or running it on the development environment. And so just a few words about the layout engine. So this is an engine that is really will control all the display on device. And so we use a physics engine to really manage all the surfaces. So consider that everything that moves between screens are managed on the cloud side by the layout engine, and every decision is done by the layout engine. The client just send API calls or send events on the screen, and then everything is processed cloud side, and the layout engine just tell the device what to do. So I will just go through all these terms. So we for the source control we're using GitLab. Jenkins is used as a CI system for building all the container images. So we use Docker because it's really useful. We use console for the service discovery part in order to keep all the parts isolated. And we use SaltStack for deploying all the application software, and SaltCloud for the VM provisioning. And so Cisco's cloud services, we name it Nimbus, it's based on OpenStack. We are using the Amsterdam data center for the deployment. So now just a few words on the microservice architecture. So we were used to build a monolithic application, but then nowadays the trend is moving to microservice application because, to be honest, it's much more easier and flexible to split the application on several parts in order to easily manage the scalability. You will not manage the scalability, the scalability on the database layer like you've done on the front end. So you need to be more flexible and think about functional parts rather than big end-to-end system. So that's why we use the microservice architecture. So just to show you how it looks like. So we've got one layer for managing all the DB store on the PubSub system. So we use MongoDB and Redis. We use a physical engine to manage, as I said, all the physical part of the UI. And we've got the LE, the layout engine core. which is based on node application. And it will contain all the API, the core, and the front end, the core, and also the synchronization API. So each blue box is a Docker container. And then on top of that, we've got the, I will show you, so this is a Colalite application, so you can, I can demonstrate it on the DevOps pod, but if need, so we've got all these boxes that are Docker container. And Docker work with Docker registry. So the registry is just a way to push all the images. So it was really useful because you can easily package the whole end-to-end system using Docker. So on the developer side, you can get the end-to-end system easily rather than installing a virtual box and launching 10 VMs, which will not work on its workstation. So you package everything within a Docker container, and you can run the end-to-end system anywhere. So then you can only need 2 minutes to run the end-to-end system. And you also have faster deployment, because the way Docker works is the first time you will get the full image, but if there is an update on the image, you will only get the updates. So you've got faster deployment. And so the registry is used, for pulling and pushing image. Now I will just go through the workflow in order to show how it works. But first thing, we heard a lot, move fast and break things. So this is a quote by Facebook, by Mark. But I will say that in this context, in our context, it's not the same thing. We need to move fast, but we need to break nothing. So running the continuous integration, so we use Jenkins. So Jenkins will, for each commit, we will build a new Docker images. And it will run also, a sandbox mode. What I mean by that is, if I update just one part of an application, Jenkins will run all the end-to-end system and perform functional tests on the end-to-end system. And if everything is working well, then the image will be pushed to the registry. Then we ensure that we have a clean registry to be used. So that's just an overview of our whole workflow. So we've got, for each commit, it goes through Jenkins that will build, make unit tests, make some good tests, and then push to the registry. And once everything is pushed to the registry, then we need to move to the cloud environment on CCS. So we've got several environments. We've got the staging one. We've got the QA one for performing load tests. And also the production environment. Each commit go automatically to the production environment. This is really key, but you know that in the DevOps approach. Just as I explained for the sandbox mode, so Jenkins will also run within a Docker container because all this part is a subset of a bigger project. And so we decided to have one master and one slave per each sub-project part. And within the Jenkins container, we run the end-to-end system, so which is also a container. And as I say, if all functional tests run well, we push the image to the registry. Then it is key to have tests at each part. So we used to make unit tests. So developer used to make unit tests, but we need more because you need to ensure that you have an end-to-end system running at any time, but also that you do not add bottlenecks. So that's why we use, as an example, we use open source tools. Nowadays, you have everything you need to do. There is a lot of open source tools to be used. And just we use that framework for making API tests, because this is really useful. Because with one line of code, you perform one test on API. And what I'm used to do is that I want that the whole team work together, and the developer are writing tests, but also the ops guy and the test guy work with in sync with the developer. We only have one team. This is not only developer, only tester, and only ops guy. Everything needs to work together, and if the ops guy are writing tests and have understanding of the code, it will really much work faster. Because if we know what the developer is doing, and if the developer know what is the operation, then it will work much faster. And then I say, so we perform end-to-end tests in order to ensure that the system is working well. And we also use Gatling for performing load tests. So it's really a simple tool, as I said. We are using a WebSocket in this case, and then we are perform automatically load tests, and you've got good dashboard as an output. This is also key to be able to expose all those results in a good way. So, and you can easily detect if you've got some failure and if you've got some issue on your system. And another part is really key also to have a well-documented system. And if you use tools like Swagger, which is linked to the code, then you ensure that what you are currently developing is well-documented and up-to-date. And what is useful using this kind of tool is that you've got a console available where you can play with the API. So it's useful on the developer side in order to test everything, to play with API, but also as it goes through the production, it's available for customer. And then you ensure that customer can play with your API rather than buying another solution. Now back on, so we are making continuous delivery, we push new Docker images to the registry, but then we need to deploy them on our client cloud environment. So we decide to use SaltStack. Previously, I was used to work with Chef, but we moved to SaltStack. And if you need more information, we are on the DevOps pod. It was much more easier to use Salt, because on the provision part, you just define map file where you define how many VMs you need, the profile, and so on. So just within two files, you are able to define your cloud environment. And with one command line, you can provision it. So it's really, really, really useful. And on top of that, we decide to design a scheduler, which is an in-house tool to orchestrate the whole deployment. So I've just made some screenshots here. So basically, it's the core component of the whole tool chain. So it uses Jenkins project, and then you've got all the environment, and you can decide at any time to deploy a new container. But basically, on background, everything is deployed automatically. But now, where we are regarding DevOps, if you're making continuous deployment, this is just half part of the whole job, because now, if you deploy, then you are in the ops world. And a lot of things need to be done. You need to continuously monitor everything. You need to to have production dashboard. You need to provide continuous feedbacks. You need to apply continuous improvement. So you've got many things to do and to consider. So let's go. To illustrate that, we have done. Let me show you. So, this short video will demonstrate how we ease the multi-screen. We ease the development on multi-screen application. So I've got an Nexus 10. Acting as a client, and we've got a PC here right now. So this is, I would say, this is a use case for service provider, especially on the video domain. So you will have an APG, so a VOD catalog, linked to a TV where you will have some movies playing. And then what will happen is that we'll have a video bridge, which will be the end of the back on the video, which will be in sync with the PC. And then we will browse the catalog and share movie details information. So let's go in action. Oh, sorry. Where's the mouse? I lose my mouse. So here, yeah, as you can see that I just move just a movie detail part, widgets, and then so everything is managed on server side. So I, on the tablet, I just, on the application side, I just send most event, touch events to the layout engine, and then the layout engine decide what to do. And then if I move to a bigger screen, then the widget comes full screen, and I can get back to the device. And so as I show you, there is a video bridge that is also in sync with the main content played on the main screen. So that's it. So it's just to illustrate that we ease the multi-screen deployment, and then as we are on the DevOps approach, everything's gonna go really faster. In order to also demonstrate other use case, we've built, I would say, a Colalite application, which is collaborative user application. I can show you on the DevOps pod just after this session, and I will. There is other session tomorrow. And as I said, so this is just a core to develop any multi-screen application. So you've got collaborative application, you can build mind map application. It's really easy. You just need on the application side to insert some library, which will just send all the client events to the layout engine, and then the layout engine will send back action to be done on the client side. So it can be HTML5 application, native application, or on Android or iPad, anyway. So now if you have any question, yeah. So is there a micro, can I have a microphone for? Yeah, but there's a lot of background noise.
So the question that I have is related to WebEx and Cisco Show and Share, for example. Those are two solutions that you guys have today that I think we have. So how about now? Okay. So the question that I had is regarding WebEx and Cisco Show and Share. So we are customers using those two products. Is this layered engine, you know, is that making it back over to those products, or are you guys not considering introducing that for such solutions?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the question.
WebEx and Cisco Show and Share. So those are two products that today we utilize for, you know, video conferencing and for content sharing between our, I'm from an education institution. So we use that, all of our students use Cisco Show and Share to view videos and sessions. So is that something that's gonna be making it to those products so that we can introduce that to our customers to use, you know, the multi-screen functionality on those products?
Sorry, I didn't hear you. Sorry.
WebEx and Cisco Show and Share.
Yeah. I need to go back. So at the moment, this was mainly done for service provider on the video side. So we did not discuss implementing this kind of framework for any collaboration tools. It is the current plan is we have some beta customer that will implement it soon, but still on the video part, because previously I was working on the service provider video software and solution business unit, but I've moved to CTO. But we can discuss, move it to working with the collaboration units to integrate this kind of framework. Okay. Other question? So thank you.